You quoted from Adam Smith, the great economist, the Scottish economist, in one of your recent columns. I was struck with it and wrote it down. Smith said, in great empires, the people who live in the capital and in the provinces remote from the scene of action feel, many of them, scarce any inconveniency from the war, but enjoy at their ease the amusement of reading in the newspapers the exploits of their own fleets and armies. Now, right after you'd written that column, I ran into some people in Washington who were talking about this. And they said, one of them asked me, well, you had Greenwald on your show. Doesn't he live on Capitol Hill? And I smile because I know you don't live on Capitol Hill or in the Capitol, and yet you write as if you are there. I mean, as if you had been listening to yesterday's cocktail parties or reading the documents that I.F. Stone used to read. How do you do that? How do you get inside the elites of the Beltway the way you do?
Well, I think a couple of things. One is technology. The technology of the internet, for example, enables constant interaction and examination of what's taking place in the Beltway without being physically present there. It's amazing the kind of access that you can actually obtain through that technology. Virtually all the communications that the political and media elite have is now available online. The documents that they produce, the policies that they espouse, the debates that they engage in, the type of thinking that that controls and shapes what it is they do can be examined much more effectively, including from afar, than ever before. And the other aspect of it that I would add is that if you live inside Washington, as is true for any culture, the culture starts shaping your own thinking. It starts infecting the way it is that you think. Everybody you speak to is infected by it. Everybody that you know is a part of it. And it's very difficult to step back and to look at it and examine it when you're too enmeshed in it. On top of that, people who live in the Beltway are invested in the people who are there. Those are their friends, those are their colleagues, the people on whom they rely for their next job and for their support. And so if you're actually removed from it, if you stay far away from it and outside of it, I think you can actually understand it better than if you're enmeshed in it and sort of subsumed by it. And if you're, the less invested you are in that culture, I think the freer you are to think about it and critique it and understand it without any fear of repercussions.
Are you ever surprised by whom you see or what you see on the Sunday morning talk shows inside the Beltway?
The pattern of who goes on those shows is so constricted and so formulaic that it's you can almost predict who's going to be on based on the news events without any fail. There is an effort underway because they've been pressured so much to start including fresher voices, different voices.
Rachel Maddow has been showing up from time to time, for example, on Meet the Press.
Right, and I think one of the reasons for that is because Meet the Press is an NBC program, and Rachel Maddow is an MSNBC personality, and there's some pressure to promote her for that reason, but it's still an important and different kind of voice to be included. And just this weekend on Meet the Press, Jane Mayer, the superb journalist who did so much excellent work on the Bush torture regime, was on Meet the Press as well, and I was noticing that she seemed almost like an animal from outer space who couldn't quite fit into the mores and conventions of the conversation. You really notice it when there's a real journalist or a different voice that's part of the conversation. And we talked about this before, but there's a very concrete set of beliefs and a concrete way of conducting political debates that these shows are structured around. And so anybody who speaks about things or thinks about things outside of those conventions has a very difficult time participating in the discussion. It's almost as though they're speaking a different language. And these shows are therefore incentivized to only have on people who are already embracing the orthodoxies on which the show is in which the show is grounded.
You recently took on one of the biggest players in Washington, the Washington Post, the editorial team at the Washington Post, for demanding that Obama's health care plan not be paid for with borrowed money, while, as you said, at the same time supporting escalating the war in Afghanistan without specifying how it should be paid for. What struck you about that?
I think that was actually one of the most illustrative and meaningful editorials because it reflects how Washington thinks. There really is this sense that it would be a luxury, something nice to do if we could do it, to provide American citizens, the millions and millions of Americans without it, with health care coverage. So that would be a nice thing to do, but it's not really urgent, it's not really necessary, and so we can't do it until we can afford it, until we don't have to borrow money in order to do it. That's what this editorial explicitly argued. By contrast, said the Washington Post editors, the war in Afghanistan is an absolute urgent necessity. There's no choice to it. It's something that we have to do. Apparently, our country will implode if we don't continue to control and occupy that country. And so, therefore, it doesn't matter whether we're paying for our foreign adventures generally and our occupation of Afghanistan specifically with that, because there's no choice. And to me, it just illustrates how warped and backwards the priorities are of the ruling class, because what we're actually allegedly doing in Afghanistan, if you look at counterinsurgency doctrine, is the idea of counterinsurgency doctrine is that we're going to not only protect the population of these foreign countries, but we're going to nation build. We're going to provide all sorts of services to them, schools and roads and infrastructure and healthcare.
Acknowledging that will take a very long time.
Decades, yeah. and extraordinary amounts of money. And so what people like the Washington Post editors and really the political elite generally are saying is that it's more important for us to go into debt to provide services to other nations so that we can control them than it is to provide services to our own citizens who lack those same services. And I think the reason for that is clear, is because the people who are saying that, people at the Washington Post editorial board, already have access to those services. They already have health care coverage. And so to them, it's just a purely abstract issue. It's a purely abstract question whether Americans who don't have health care coverage can have it. But I think that they're reflecting what the priorities are, that it doesn't matter what our foreign adventures and foreign domination costs, we do it no matter what. But everyone inside the United States, ordinary Americans, have to wait and can't get basic services from the government as long as we have to go into debt in order to pay for it.
The editorial did say that wars come to an end, entitlements never do.
Right.
It did say that.
It did. It made that claim. But if you look at the way in which we have been fighting wars since the end of World War II, it's very hard to say that wars come to an end. It may be true that individual specific wars come to an end, but the idea of the United States fighting wars is something that seems to exist no matter what. We constantly find new enemies. We constantly find reasons to fight war. We're basically a nation perpetually at war. I mean, the 90s were supposedly the time of peace, the time that we went into a peace posture and enjoyed a peace dividend after the fall of the Soviet Union, and yet even throughout the 90s, we continued to engage in military actions inside other countries far more than any other country, in fact, all the other countries in the world combined. And certainly in this last decade, we've been nothing but an occupier and a bomber and an invader of foreign countries with no end in sight. I mean, if you listen to government officials, they don't talk about the war ending anytime soon. They call it the long war in government documents, and they talk about it lasting decades at least. So I think the idea that, oh, the end of the war is around the corner and therefore it can be distinguished from entitlements is a fantasy.
Well, Andrew J. Bacevich, whom you know and have quoted, was at this table, wrote the book The Limits of Power, and has recently said and reiterated the fact that war is a permanent condition in American society today, not only because there might be ready, steady fighting, but because of the accumulated cost and all the money that's being spent on preparing for the next episode. And he says that war has become a permanent condition of America. Do you agree with that?
I absolutely agree with that. And I think it's really the central political fact that Americans need to re-examine. And the reason for that is because it's not just that wars cost an enormous amount of money and drain our resources. I mean, they do. I mean, the wars that we fight are being paid for by money that we borrow from China, Japan, Saudi Arabia, and a variety of other countries. It's not just that enormous numbers of people are killed, both our own citizens and the citizens of the country that we attack. That's also true. But if you look at hit countries throughout history that can be described, as ours should be described, as permanent warfighting states, then you see that the character of the country changes in all sorts of radical and fundamental ways. When you're fighting a war, it means that the government has claims to far more power than it does when wars aren't being fought. The executive branch has all kinds of claims to unfettered and unchecked power. There are secrecy justifications that are made constantly and are accepted in the name of war that allow the government to exist in a very opaque fashion. So beyond all the moral cost and the financial cost and the human costs of endless war, which are by themselves sufficient to make this endless war posture something that's horrible, it changes the nature of what kind of country we are. And I think more than anything, that's the debate that's missing. What is it doing to the United States to say that we are going to devote as our primary activity, our resources to being a warrior state, a state that fights wars permanently?
But the Washington Post editorial went on to say that our national security is involved in what is happening in Afghanistan. It was a base for the attacks of 9/11. It is right there in a very sensitive area of the world where there are a lot of potential, if not immediate adversaries and enemies of the United States, and that you have to clean the swamp, so to speak, of those potential threats to America before you can have a healthy society with everybody enjoying universal health care. And that's the point at which, if you read their website, so many of other denizens of Washington responded, said, yes, we have to keep in mind this is an issue of national security, not just of national quality of life.
Here's what amazes me about that point, which I think is the conventional wisdom in Washington culture. In 2004, the Pentagon commissioned a study where Donald Rumsfeld asked, are the policies that we're pursuing, namely the war in Afghanistan, the war in Iraq, helping the problem of terrorism or worsening the problem of terrorism? And what this study concluded, and it was a Pentagon study, was that the crucial threat, the central threat to American national security comes in the form of anti-American sentiment. The only reason why people are willing to strap on bombs to their waist or give their lives up to drive airplanes, to steer airplanes into our buildings, is because they're so consumed with hatred towards the United States that they're willing to give up their own lives just to inflict some minor tragedy, some minor harm on the empire. That's the central national security threat. And this study concluded what ought to have been obvious, which is that the more we invade and occupy other countries in the Muslim world, the more we kill Muslim civilians, the more imagery that we create of prisons being created where we put Muslims without any charges of any kind, the more hatred there is towards the United States, and therefore the greater the terrorist threat is. And so, you know, to me, what I wrote about recently is I think the central problem is a lack of empathy. And my biggest wish is that every American in sort of a national collective exercise would spend just 10 minutes thinking about the following question, which is, suppose there was a Muslim country that invaded the United States with 150,000 troops and proceeded to occupy our country for the next 8 years, dropped bombs on wedding parties, slaughtered men, women, and children who were innocent, created prisons in our country where they arrested American citizens and put us for years without charges, created an overseas island prison where they shipped some of us to there without any recourse whatsoever, and at the same time were threatening to do that to several other Western countries, how much rage and anger and a desire for vengeance and violence would we feel towards that country that was doing that to us? I mean, just look at what the singular one-day attack of 9/11, the kind of anger and rage it unleashed. And I think if Americans were to think about how we would react towards other countries and what we would want to do to them, if they were doing to us what we are now doing to them, I think a lot of light would be shined on what it is that we're really achieving in terms of our national security.